I'm glad you guys are still awake and up, so I'll ask you guys some questions to keep you alert, I hope. I'm Dr. Khadijia Tribie Reid. I'm a pediatrician here in Wilmington. I work at MedNorth Health Center. MedNorth is a community health center. That means that we take care of people, whether they're insured or uninsured. Years ago, I was working at the Carousel Center for abused children. For those of you who do not know, the Carousel Center is a place where children who are suspected to have been abused come to be evaluated. It takes a multidisciplinary team to examine these cases. So we may have a police officer, a social worker, a family caretaker, a foster parent there. And together, they would build the story and tell me the story, usually of a child who was possibly unruly in school, or maybe had a lot of medical concerns, often just didn't act like a child their age should act. And certainly, I would go into the room with these children, and I would talk to them, and I would talk to a four-year-old who sounded like a two-year-old to me, and I would talk to a six-year-old who sounded like a three-year-old to me, and it just kept happening over and over and over again. The other story that this multidisciplinary team built for me is they told me a story of the environment. And that environment might be a mom who's mentally ill, or a father who was incarcerated, or a grandmother who always stands out on this particular corner. Everybody knew that there was chaos in their family. And I said, "Oof, there's gotta be a connection between chaos and developmental delay. Chaos and ADHD, chaos and multiple medical issues, there's gotta be a connection there." And that leads me to what we found out and what many of us already know at this point. So, toxic stress. There is regular stress. There is positive stress, okay? So that's just the stress you have before you run a big race, before you take a test. It's brief, it's intermittent, it's going to be over soon. Then there's tolerable stress. It's not normal. You know, a grandparent dies, a person gets sick, but hopefully you have someone, a loved one there to help you through it as a child or even as an adult. And then there's toxic stress. This is stress that goes on and on and on and on every day of your life. You experience this stress. And so in the life of a child who's growing and developing, brain changing, lungs changing, kidneys changing, guess what? It's significant. So not only did I see this pattern of chaos and abnormalities at the Carousel Center, but when I moved on to MedNorth Health Center, I saw it over and over and over and over again. I was referring a third of my patients out. I was seeing physical abnormalities that I only saw in Texas Children's Hospital, one of the best residency programs in the country. I was seeing things that were only in textbooks in my patients, right here in Wilmington, North Carolina. So often when I would send them over to behavioral health to address this ADHD, the behavioral health provider would say, "You do know he saw his father get shot when he was two. You do know his mother has serious mental illness." There were things that I couldn't capture in my 15-minute visit. I needed behavioral health to help me through. So this is a bit of a chaotic little schematic that I created several years ago, but it made me feel really good to see Dr. Father Gill have a schematic that was somewhat similar in that it talked about the interconnections and the networks that needed to happen to address toxic stress. The main things I want you to understand is the points we talk about when we talk about this thing called ACEs that we keep referring to, adverse childhood experiences or events. These are things like a mental health problems in a caretaker, being in foster care, all the things that would lead you to foster care, having to go from place to place to place to place, okay? All these transitional things really accumulate over time. And the more of these things you have, the more likely you are as an adult to have physical, mental, developmental issues. And so this explained everything I was saying. It rang true for me beautifully. So these are some of the sequela that we see from toxic stress. So it can be physical manifestations, or they can be developmental. And developmental was what I kept seeing over and over again in my clinic and what I continue to see every day. Some of these things you guys are seeing too, and it's coming at you as, he's seven, why is he wet in the bed? It's coming at you as, he's so hyper, just so hyper. Anger management, these are kids throwing desks across the classroom sometimes, just out of control behaviors. And we're thinking, it's just a bad kid. And they're getting a diagnosis. But there's a whole environmental factor that we have to, as a culture, kind of start taking into account. And this is just on a regular day. So when I talked about those stressors, certainly a hurricane shouldn't be a toxic stress. But for some people it is. Imagine my patients, 9 months after the storm, still homeless, still going from house to house to house. That baby was born 9 months ago. For all of their life, they've been homeless. Or that baby was born 3 months ago. For three of those months, 6 of those months, mom was pregnant, toxically stressed herself while that baby was trying to develop in her womb. So understand that our brains, our bodies, our endocrine system is always shooting out chemicals, and those chemicals are going to decide what type of baby we have and what kind of outcome we have in terms of our own health, especially when we're developing children. So this is what this work of ACEs is all about. And certainly in the face, even at baseline, it's significant, but certainly in the face of a storm, especially for our most vulnerable populations, it's significant. So resilience, we talk about resilience. You know, you see this beautiful flower coming through the tar, through the cement. And you think about some of the things that Dr. Fothergill talked about, what was Sierra's story and what made her a little bit more resilient than some of those other children. And we really do know that if a child has one caretaker that's with them, that's consistent, that's in their life, that can make all the difference in the world. So I'm going to tell you a story. But first, I'm going to introduce you to this. This is called the socio-ecological framework. So when we think about problems, whether they're public health problems or medical problems or otherwise, but social problems specifically, we can look at this framework and kind of think how they apply. So I'm going to use myself as an example, and I want you to be looking at this framework as I use myself as an example. And then we'll talk about some of the things you wrote on your paper and how can it be applied to our families here with Hurricane Florence. I think the framework is relatively self-explanatory. But as you can see, you're looking at this issue from many perspectives, the perspective of individual factors, interpersonal factors, that may be the family, their social network, institutions, and then communities, and then policies. So we've kind of addressed all of those today, so this fits perfectly in what we're going to talk about. So let me tell you my story. This is actually a true story. Several years ago, I lived in New Orleans, Louisiana. I was in residency. I was training to become a pediatrician specifically. I was already a physician, and I was training to become a pediatrician. And I decided, I had a golden weekend, and these are the few rare weekends when you're not on call, Friday, Saturday, or Sunday. So I decided I was gonna visit Chicago and visit a friend. So I went to Chicago to visit a friend. And as I was leaving New Orleans, several of my colleagues said, you know, there's a storm supposed to be coming. Well, in New Orleans, there's always a storm that's supposed to be coming. And as the people of New Orleans say, you just wade in the water, okay? And that's really how people thought of it, because they lived with the threat of storms always. And so I went on to Chicago. And when I got there, maybe within a day or two, my then boyfriend, now husband, calls and said, you know, I'm gonna go to Arkansas. This thing is really hitting. Yeah, it's hitting. They're gonna call it Katrina. Oh, okay, all right, whatever. I'll see y'all Sunday, no problem. And so Saturday rolls around, and in fact, it hits. Sunday rolls around, the water's higher than it was Saturday, and people are wading in waist-deep water, and I'm thinking I'm going back home, and my friend is telling me, I don't think you're going back home right now. And so I said, well, let me just check. And sure enough, of course, I can't go home. Monday comes around, I'm still not going home. And I'm looking at the TV, just staring at it, like I live across, I could see the convention center from my apartment complex. Those people are at the convention center, without water, without food, without beverage. And I'm sitting at my friend's house. On about day three or four, my friend says, look, she's a lawyer. She says, I got a trial. Can you go stay at my mama's house, please? Because I've got to get ready for this trial, and I don't like to have people at the house. I say, okay. So I get my bags, and I go to her mom's house. And about day five or six, they probably have a come to Jesus meeting with me and say, I don't think you're going home. You're not going to get back to New Orleans anytime soon. Maybe you should go to your mom's house in Atlanta. So I get a flight, and I go to Atlanta. And for the next 2-3 weeks, I'm in Atlanta, and somebody starts a Facebook group or some kind of group, and I realize within 2 or 3 weeks, somebody says, okay, our program is going to pay us. We're going to get paid for these time we're off. Good, that's good. Where am I going to work? How am I going to finish my residency? This is my last year of residency. And then someone says, they've set up a program where we can go to Houston, Texas, and work and finish our residency in Houston, Texas. So I go. I go to New Orleans, get my stuff, because finally, a month later, we're able to go into the city, and I take my stuff, and I go to Houston, Texas, and I work at one of the best children's hospitals in the country, and I get paid. And I remember I lived in somebody's garage for a little while. There was a kindness of a person in Houston who said, you can, Katrina, victims can stay here for free. And until I got my apartment in Houston, I stayed there. And I remember probably within 3 months or 4 months of being there, I was looking for a parking space, a very simple act that we all do in this huge garage at Texas Children's, and I just couldn't find a parking space. And I just cried and cried and cried and cried. So for all those months, I had been putting one foot in front of the other, going one step at a time, and that moment, that stress hit me. Okay. It's not too sad of a story, quite honestly, because if you think about it, there were multiple protective factors there for me. Consider, and this is your turn to speak. What were the individual factors, the things about me that protected me from the storm? Literally and physically, what protected me? What's that? I was out of town. I was able to evacuate, but why was I able to evacuate? I hear finances. I had the money to go. Any other individual factors that helped me? Education. How about me? Just me, education. I think it helped. I think it had I had a job, had education, okay? Interpersonal, I already heard somebody say I had friends. So we were connected with one another, and they were telling us what was gonna happen. What about, where did I go? Where was I during the storm? Yeah, we're friends. And then when I couldn't stay with that friend, where did I go? Family, friend family. And then where did I go when I couldn't stay with friend family? Home to my mama, more family. So I had connections. I had space I could go to. And then institutions. How did institutions help me in this situation? I got paid. Colleagues. My institution set up a place where I could still go. And how did the community of Houston, Texas help me? I could think of at least one way. Rent-free a month, I stayed in that garage. Okay, until I was able to get myself situated. And then finally, institutions, structures, what policies were in place? I think I was allowed to practice. Yeah, I didn't expect anyone to get that, but usually you do have to have a state license to practice. There was all those that red, tape was cut, and I was able to practice. All right, now, you got us. You got it. You know how to use this. You can use this in any situation, in any issue. Now, let's apply it to Hurricane Florence. What are the individual factors that protect our residents, protected our residents, will protect our residents in future storms? Individual factors. Preparation and knowledge, good. Finances. Oh, experience, I know what to do, I did this before, okay. Maybe education. Don't be afraid to say it. maybe education, you know. Okay, good. What are the interpersonal factors that will help our folks through the storm? Social connections, churches, family, okay, friends. All right, here we come, here we go. We gotta jump in here now. This is us, this is our part. Institutions and operations, what did we do right? What do we need to do differently? What lessons did we learn from the storm? Institutions. There were resources. People did gather. People did find what their thing was and jump in and do that. That was awesome. What else? Some people got paid. Some people got paid. Maybe some people didn't. And so maybe that's something that businesses locally need to consider. Do we have an emergency fund? Do we need to have something policy-wise that says you have to have an emergency fund for your employees? I don't know. How do we structure that in the future? What else? Anything else? Institutions? Why? That we can do better? These are things we need to be thinking about. Mm-hmm. Have an emergency plan. Hospital remain open, I presume. You know, how do people get medications? How did people who had diabetes refrigerate their insulin? Okay. Community, larger community. I mean, there was a lot of volunteerism going on. When I think about people responding to their own calling, I think about that chef who came from Puerto Rico and set up a world kitchen. Like, wow, let's talk about a calling. And then individuals who did things during the storm that they thought they were capable of doing, okay? I was at the Women to Watch, or the Women Achievement Award last night, and the woman who owns Pine Valley Market went to the World Kitchen and worked. She had that ability, that skill. Yes?
I was just gonna say, I just lost my train of thought now. And I'm over 60, so.
You can bring it back. This is the really cool one, and the one I'm still trying to wrap my hands around. But you know, we've got, yes.
NC Baptist Net.
Yes, that was phenomenal. That group was phenomenal. They fed people, they cut people's trees, they set up, and they got to work. Yeah, that's wonderful. Yes?
I think that across the whole city and the whole region, there was an abundance of different kinds of faith communities that really, really came together and were a source of strength, and hope, and help to the broader community. It was really, that to me was my big plus takeaway, was how regardless of who you were, what you had, what you needed, they were in it.
And they showed up from all over. In North Chase neighborhood, there was a group that came in. The people were from all over the country. They flew in. They didn't know how they were going to get there or how their transportation was going to be once they got there. But they came into the neighborhoods. They set up tents. They set up heating areas, heating stations, everything that went out from under your house. You know, safely, masks, Clorox.
I think there was a phenomenal response, quite honestly. I think we always have to be in mode of continually improving and figure out where we need to do more. But I think the response was kind of unbelievable, quite honestly. All right, yes?
I think one of the things, too, that we need to continue to be aware of is there were people who came in from other places, but they came in to rip you off. And so if you found, people that take advantage of grandma because the tree is on her house and they're charging her $8,000 and somebody can do it almost for free. And the other thing I think that I learned community-wise was that, for example, in my house, my back fence got knocked down. And I actually got to meet the guy next door.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot more of our neighbors too.
Situation with the hurricane here, and then Florida got
road closures or road openings, people share back
routes to get back
and so forth.
That's true. There's a lot of that.
It really came together.
Technology ended up being a huge advantage. All right, so that last but not least, systems, policies, you know, bigger issues, national, state, big deal, community, county. What helped us? What could have been better? What do we need to think about in terms of bigger systems? So it's kind of cool that Rebecca's here. She's from the state, and she talked a little bit about this. Yes. Yes, Rob.
Better communication on evacuations. Mm-hmm. Second, shelters. Identifying them and making sure they are clearly hardened structures that have roofs that won't leak, generators that won't fail at the most critical time.
Wow. Lessons learned. That's our Commissioner Rob Zappel, just in case you don't know. Yes, Ms. Michelle.
So that's a great job. I'm just going to confirm that at the local level as well as at the state level, because I actually couldn't answer that question for you. There's some incredible work that is going on at DHHS at the state level, that's going on with emergency management at the state level, and believe it or not, even today, this morning, the county HR strategy, DSS, public health, partnering together so that we can prepare for the next time this happens and work on our lessons learned and offer training to our staff so that the next time this happens, we are more prepared. So there's some awesome work, I can promise you, going on behind the scenes.
Create a plan to address something like that. You guys have been wonderful. I just have to show you my last slide because she's just cute. This is my now 6-year-old who I must tell you is extremely competitive, and I'll tell you this brief story and then I'll sit down. So I was telling someone last night I was nominated for the Women of Achievement Awards, and so I was sitting there waiting. Well, let me say. So I was nominated, and once again, my 6-year-old is very competitive, so the first thing she said is she was seeing everybody's highlight reel roll up and little speeches, pre-recorded speeches. She said, "Did you write a good speech?" I was like, "I don't know." She's like, and then later when they finally got to my category, she said, "Did you win?" I said, "No." She said, "You gotta do better stuff." just working on doing better stuff. Thank you. Thank you, guys.